So I will explain the ground motion selection procedure quickly for an example high-rise building which was located in Karachi city of Pakistan. It was a 40 plus story building. Okay, so it is a high-rise building. So let me quickly show you that how I was able to finally select the selection criteria for actually selecting ground motions, downloading those ground motions for this particular site. So I know the coordinates for the site of my building, and I also have the PSHA results for this site. Probabilistic seismic hazard assessment of this site was carried out to construct the hazard curves and to construct the uniform hazard spectrum. So I already have the uniform hazard spectra for both MCE level and SLE level, service level earthquake, which is used in the performance based design of that building. So which means that I don't need to go to a particular building code and construct my own response spectrum, because that response spectrum is already given from a PSHA study. So these are different hazard curves for PGA, for SS, spectral acceleration at 0.2 second, then spectral acceleration at 1 second and at 2 seconds. So using these hazard curves or using these spectra which is available for that particular city, I can directly use them for the purpose of this selection of ground motions. So all the PGA values, spectral acceleration values for MCE and DBE levels, they are given to me from the PSHA study. So it means that no need to go to a building code prescribed spectrum. So these are the final site specific response spectra for the MCE level and SCE level for this particular project site. So this is MCE level spectrum, this is SLE level spectrum, and they are basically MCE is defined as 2% probability of exceedance in 50 years, and SLE level is 50% probability of exceedance in 30 years. And they are the original MCE level spectra, they are not MCER. So these values are not modified for risk targeting. Then more importantly, I mentioned deaggregation in the lecture. I had the deaggregation results for this particular site. Okay, so I know exactly that which seismic sources can govern the seismic hazard at this site. Seismic deaggregation analysis is a process which actually tells us that what is the contribution of different seismic sources in the overall seismic hazard. Okay, so I, for example, if I say that my PGA value is 0.5 G, this deaggregation analysis will give me, it will tell me that let's say 70% of this 0.5 G is coming from a particular fault A, okay, fault A, and 20% is coming from fault B, and let's say 10% is coming from fault C. So it decomposes, this process of deaggregation decomposes the seismic hazard results into contributions of the individual seismic sources towards the overall seismic hazard. Okay, so in short, this gives me the magnitude and distance pair, because the seismic hazard 0.5 G is a result of many magnitude earthquakes and many distances. But this deaggregation will give me those MR pair, magnitude and source to site distance pair, which contribute the most towards this number. Okay, so we have, for example, in case of this city which our project is in, for PGA value, for SS, for S1, and for spectral acceleration at 2 second, at DBE level, for example, in this case, 10% probability of exceedance in 50 years, 475 year return period. We have the MR pairs corresponding to each hazard parameter. So this means that this 6.42 magnitude at a distance of 53.2 kilometer is the mean MR pair for PGA hazard. Similarly, this is the modal MR pair for PGA value. So this process, these are directly the results of that deaggregation. Let me show you those results graphically. This table is similar table but for MC11, and this table basically tells us, this is for DB11, this table, but basically tells us that how much is the percentage contribution of each seismic source. These are the seismic sources. It says that what is the percentage contribution of each seismic source and what R and M pair is basically contributing that. So which means that we can pick the ultimate goal is to pick the magnitude range and source to site distance range which should be used for the selection of ground motions based on this understanding that what seismic sources are contributing towards that, towards the seismic hazard at that particular site. So this is for now MC11 for the same site. These are the deaggregation results in graphical form. This is for the same site. On the right hand side, you have on the map different columns with different colors, and the color is showing the magnitude value, and the height of a particular column is showing you how much it is contributing towards the seismic hazard. So which means that finally on the map you can see that if this is your site, let's say this is my site, how far from my site different magnitudes are contributing towards the seismic hazard and how much they are contributing. So if for example this blue column have a distance of let's say 50 kilometer, and the blue color means that it has a magnitude of let's say 5.7, somewhere in between 5.7. So I can say that, and it is contributing the highest, it is the highest column. So I can say that a magnitude of 5.7 occurring at a distance of 50 kilometer is the most contributing MR pair which is contributing towards the seismic hazard at my site. Okay, so this pair should be used for the selection of ground motions at that particular site. On the left hand side you have the same information, but instead of plotting directly on the graph on the map, you have those columns where you have one distance axis and one magnitude axis. So basically the floor here of this 3D graph is all, each point on that is an MR pair, and height is basically the percentage contribution to the hazard. So the height of each MR pair is telling you that how much percent it is contributing towards the hazard at my site. So the highest column is contributing obviously the maximum, that MR pair is contributing the maximum. That previous graph was for DB11 and now this is for MC11. So you can read these deaggregation results to finally come up with a magnitude range and a distance range which you should use for the purpose of selection of ground motions. So these are for SS. Obviously these plots will not only for DB and MC, these will be for the hazard also. Those ones were for PGA, this is for SS, and then this is for S1. So all of these deaggregation results should be reviewed for your site if you want to come up with a realistic magnitude range and a distance range. So now this is the summary that for S1 values, which means spectral acceleration at 0.2 second, both DB and MCE hazard values, shallow seismicity 0 to 50 kilometer dominate the seismic hazard. For S1 and spectral acceleration at 2 seconds, for both MC and DB, Makran subduction zone, this is a subduction zone locating close to the site, shows the dominant contribution. So shallow seismicity, this is one source, Makran subduction zone is another source. So they are participating the most, and the range which we can identify from deaggregation results is this one, magnitude 6.4 to magnitude 8.2. This range should be used for the selection of ground motion. This is the final recommendation for the from the deaggregation results. And the distance range is 40 to 150 kilometer. Okay, because here you have 0 to 50 kilometer background seismicity governing, and here you have Makran subduction zone, which is more than 100 kilometers from this particular site. So we have finally selected 40 to 150 kilometer as a distance range which can be used for the selection of ground motions. Then faulting mechanism we also have to provide for this particular site for the selection of ground motion. So then we studied the active faults which are located near Karachi, this particular site, and which are participating the most in this hazard at this site. So these are all the faults and their faulting mechanisms which are located near Karachi city. And then we studied all of these faults, their location. This map actually shows the location of these four faults A, B, C, D, and this red zone, the site is basically in the red zone, and this fault A, fault B, this is fault D, then this is C, and there is one fault B which is passing exactly from the middle of this red zone, very close to our site. So finally, based on this study, we selected this selection criteria, and that is that we will use the reverse fault type, because the most contributing or most closest fault to our site was having the reverse fault type, and we will use this magnitude range based on deaggregation results. We will use this RJB and R rupture 40 to 150 kilometer. We will use, because the site class was SD, so corresponding to that the VS30 range is 180 to 360. So we will use that one. We will use 30 to 50 seconds of the significant duration of ground motions. This is to ensure that enough number of cycles are available for the building to develop peak response. And we just keep it up to 50 seconds, because if we have a ground motion which is maybe 70 or 100 second, that will take significant amount of analysis time, and the extraction of result will also be very difficult. So 30 to 50 second is our range for significant duration, and we say that we don't require pulse like ground motions. Okay, we just selected no pulse like records. So this is the selection criteria which we finalized based on this study for this particular project. So similar kind of study you also have to perform for your projects, your real buildings, where you have to actually justify each of the selection criteria and its values. So this is all about the finalization of selection criteria for a particular real building project.